Good evening. Indian Medical College welcomes you all to this online class. Dear viewers, in today's session, we have our enthusiastic and energetic speaker, Dr. Soumya Chakrabarty Bhattacharya, Professor and Head of Department of Anatomy from ESI PGI MSR, Kolkata with us. She is having plenty of teaching and practical experience behind her. She'll be taking class on Crash Course in Embryology today. Good evening, ma'am, and welcome. It's an immense pleasure to have you here with us, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. It's indeed an opportunity. And without spending much time, let me start with the general embryology first. Now, my dear students, as I do the general embryology, I shall like to start with certain terms which you are very much aware of, which is a probable viva question or MCQ. Like you know, reproduction is survival through new generations. Ontogeny is the complete life cycle. Embryology is the prenatal stages of development. Phylogeny is the evolutionary history of a group of organisms or organs. Growth is increase in bulk cell number. Differentiation is sequential integrated system differentiation of the tissues and organs. Now, what is most important is the totipotent and the pluripotent cells. There's a fine difference between the two. The totipotent cells is basically its cell can produce separate embryo under favorable condition. So it can produce an embryo, while the pluripotent cells are groups of cells. So here it's one cell. Here it's multiple cells which can produce specific type of tissues in early embryogenesis. So these terminologies are very important for our, the oral or the MCQ point of view. Now coming to the gametogenesis and we can see that we all know that the sperm and the ovum, that oocyte, it unites to form the zygote. Now what happens, we have a diagram on the right hand side. Now these gametes are derived from the primordial germ cells. Now wherever you see the bold, you know that because this is a crash course, I can't do in much details in 1 hour. So you know that these are the probable things to remember. So these are formed in the epiblast along the wall of the, this is the yolk sac, and along its wall it is formed. And we all know that germ cells undergo gametogenesis, which includes meiosis, that is reduction in the number of the chromosomes. Now, this transport of gametes, now this is important. This is, this is a very favorite oral question. Where does fertilization take place? Because you all know that uterine tube has certain parts. Now, just before the ovulation, now I have not done the ovulation and the menstrual cycle here, which is equally important in both anatomy and physiology. So just before the ovulation, the infundibulum moves closer to ovary, and fimbria, these are the fimbria. So the fimbria also move over the surface of the ovary, capture the oocyte and transport it to ampulla. Now, how is it transported? Through the peristaltic waves. Now, I expect my students to practice this diagram. Now, there is another term called teratoma. Teratoma is basically the tumor which is of disputed origin. It can have bone, it can have hair, it can have muscle, gut, epithelia, anything. Therefore, it can have pluripotent stem cells. So, it can form any organ or tissue. And how does it happen? When the primordial germ cells, they dissociate from the normal migratory path, it forms these tumors. sometimes you may hear that there was pain abdomen, and when it was operated, there was one ball of hair. So if it is congenital, it can be a teratoma, and these are nothing but the tumors of disputed origin. Now, you all know how the chromosomal inheritance occurs. I'm not going to do the genetics part of it. But I would like you to remember that approximately there are 35,000 genes on 46 chromosomes. And out of which 23 homologous pairs forms the 46, 22 autosomes and one pair of sex chromosomes. This we all know. XX and XY. Now, this one chromosome of each pair from maternal gamete is the oocyte and paternal gamete is the sperm. So, you all know how the union takes place. And over here, I would like you to remind you that just when you are preparing for the first MBBS, please give just a 5-10 minutes reading of the mitosis and meiosis and crossover, so that this is just a revision before you start either genetics or the general embryology. Now, coming to gametogenesis, now this is a process of meiosis where the germ cells, they mature to male and female gametes. So gametogenesis in male is spermatogenesis, in female is oogenesis. Now, as I have written down, the reed, mitosis, meiosis, crossing over and polar bodies. Now here you can see the primary oocyte divides to secondary oocyte and then to mature oocyte, and we get three polar bodies. Whereas when we look at the primary spermatocyte, we get two secondary spermatocytes and we get four spermatids. So we find that there is no polar body when we are looking at the spermatogenesis. Now, birth defects and the abortions. Now, there can be some chromosomal and genetic factors. Now, when you see these factors, I will suggest that, my dear students, you study genetics and general embryology simultaneously. It gives you a better understanding, better you will be able to remember during exam, and it serves your purpose. So, 50% of the conceptions end in spontaneous abortion. So you can see how common it is. Out of which 50% are due to major chromosomal abnormalities. Therefore, it calls you for a good reading of the chromosomes and the genetics. 25% of the conceptors have major chromosomal defects. So, most common is the Turner syndrome 45X, triploidy, trisomy 16, and my dear students, please don't forget the Klinefelter syndrome also. And due to chromosomal abnormalities, it is 7% of major birth defects, and gene mutations is additional 8%. Now, the numerical abnormalities are euploidy. We get the term euploidy, which is an exact multiple of diploid, triploid. Aneuploidy is when it's not an euploidy. That's an extra chromosome is present, when we call it trisomy. Or when one is missing, it's called monosomy. And now these abnormalities, when does it occur? It occurs during mitosis and meiosis. And that is why I have said, please read the mitosis, meiosis before you start general embryology. Now remember, at least one question you definitely get from general embryology, at least one. So it is that important. So it gets, at the time of birth, the cells are in diploting stage. Now, primary oocytes are in prophase, in the diploting phase, and they do not finish the first meiotic division before puberty. Then, under the influence of this oocyte maturation inhibitor, now the whole process begins. During childhood, most oocytes become atretic, and around 400,000, they reach the puberty, and then fewer than 500 ovulation starts or ovulation gets initiated and continues till menopause sets in. Now, the primary oocytes are vulnerable to damage as they age. Each month, around 15 to 20 follicles, they mature, passing through three stages. So one of the potential short note is the maturation of oocyte, where you will draw the primary oocyte to matured oocyte to three polar bodies. And these three stages are the primary or the pre-antral stage, secondary or antral stage, it's the longest stage, and the pre-ovulatory. This part is indeed very important from physiology point of view also. Now, formation of primary follicles. Let us concentrate on this diagram on the right-hand side. So you get the primordial follicle with flat epithelial cells. Then these flat epithelial cells become cuboidal epithelial cells. What else can you see? You can see a thin line of the zona pellucida. So the cells, the follicle grows and the cells secrete the zona pellucida. Zona pellucida is a very, very important short note or an oral question. And then in the finally, when you see that there are stratified layers of granulosa cells around the developing oocyte, you get a thickened zona pellucida, and this stage is known as primary follicle. So what is the difference between primordial to primary follicle? Primordial follicle doesn't have the zona pellucida, has only flat cells. The growing follicle has a layer of zona pellucida with the cuboidal cells, and the primary follicle has stratified layer of granulosa cells with a layer of the zona pellucida. Therefore, coming to the maturation, initially we find that as the stratified cells appear, there is a lunar-shaped cavity which is formed. And these granulosa cells, it secretes the glycoproteins on the surface of the oocyte, which forms the zona pellucida. I have asked you to read and make a short note on the zona pellucida and draw. These two diagrams will be enough for you to practice and draw. Now, ultimately what happens is the stratified cell layer becomes thin. There is an antral cavity, which this lunar-shaped cavity, it increases. And around it, you get two layers of cells, the theca interna and externa. As the antral cavity increases in size, we can see that in one of the poles, you can see the stratified cells along with the developing oocyte, and this is known as the cumulus euphoricus or cumulus euphorus. So this diagram is very important, where you get the antral cavity fully formed and you get the cumulus euphorus. Now this continues in the puberty. So we get a Graafian follicle. And this Graafian follicle, and then these secondary follicles mature and you get the luteinizing hormone, which induces pre-ovulatory growth phase. So I will again ask you to practice these two diagrams, where you get the stratification of the cells and the secretion of the glycoproteins, and in the other you get the cumulus euphoricus and zona pellucida is well formed. So when we do the spermatozoa is actually, it passes through the cervical canal, enters the uterine cavity, meets the oocyte in the ampulla. Millions are released, one fertilizes. How, we will see. We have already done it, I'm sure, but this is just a revision. Now, capacitation. What is capacitation? Practice this shortly. Capacitation is the process of final maturation of spermatozoa. And this final maturation, it acquires a coat of glycoprotein on acrosome. So what you are required here is, how does a mature sperm look like? What are the parts of the matured sperm? What is an acrosomal cap? How does the tailpiece look like? So you have to read this. Now, it is very interesting that those sperm which do not undergo capacitation are not capable of acrosomal reaction during fertilization. So spermatogenesis and spermiogenesis are two different terms. Spermatogenesis is basically the spermatogonia to spermatozoa by the LH or the luteinizing hormone. Testosterone also gets secreted. Now, FSH is important because it binds to the Sertoli cells. You all know there are two types of cells, Sertoli cells and leading cells. Coming to the spermiogenesis, this difference comes, distinguish between spermatogenesis and spermiogenesis, or it can come independently also. Spermiogenesis has three changes. Mainly, one is the acrosome, I have already said. Then condensation of nucleus, the neck, middle piece and tail formation, and the shedding of the cytoplasm. So when you write this, you can remember it like this. And it takes about 64 days for this spermiogenesis to occur. Coming to fertilization, which is occurring in the ampulla. Now, you can see that there are so many sperm here. But what happens actually is, only one sperm can enter. So it passes through corona radiata. You can see the cell layers of corona radiata and the zona pellucida and the perivitelline space surrounding the oocyte. So it has to pass through the corona radiata. Here the zona pellucida plays a big role. As it passes, you can see so many sperms. This is the multi-layered corona radiata here. The sperm head binds with the glycoprotein on the zona pellucida, and this white line is the zona pellucida. And then the acrosomal reaction takes place and only one will be entering. So what is the principal function of zona pellucida? It initiates the acrosomal reaction. It helps in the zonal reaction. So the head of spermatozoon comes in contact with the zona pellucida here. You can see the right-hand diagram. Please follow it. There's certain release of enzymes and only one sperm can enter. So zona pellucida becomes impermeable immediately and it prevents polyspermia. Cleavage is another term when zygote undergoes mitotic divisions, and so you can get a 2-cell stage, 4-cell stage, 8, 16, and this is a morula. It happens on day 4. So this can come, cleavage can come as a short note or an oral question, and morula also. Many a times we get these questions. Important is blastocyst. Blastocyst is basically the outer cell mass of the trophoblast, which forms the extraembryonic membrane, and the inner cell mass on one pole. Now the rest is the fluid collected cavity, which we call blastocoel. Practice this diagram. Comes the implantation. So it's on the day 5, day 6, 7. We are almost finishing the first week. So it gets implanted and zona is preventing polyspermy, and embryo is ready on day 6, 7 for implantation in the upper part of posterior wall of uterus. It is asked, where does fertilization take place? Ampulla. Where does implantation take place? Upper part, posterior wall of uterus. If it is wrongly implanted, we can get conditions like placenta previa and all. And if it is wrongly fertilized at wrong place, we can get we can also get the ectopic pregnancy. And if it is wrongly fertilized, then the zygote doesn't occur at all. Now, therefore, we get abnormal spermatozoa 10% with observable defects, and sperm with morphologic abnormalities, that is immotile. Now, in this context, I would like you to remember this, because we have plenty of cases of infertility these days. Now, if I have to summarize the first week, then you will see that there is gametogenesis occurring, there are birth defects happening, there are different abnormalities of chromosomes. I would want my students of Indian medical colleges to read about the various abnormalities, both the numerical and structural chromosomal abnormalities, which is a potential question in MBBS. Now comes the second week. Second week is the day 8, where it is implanted and you get the blastocyst cavity, you get the inner cell mass, look at the diagram on the right, and then you get the trophoblastic layer, cell layer. And now here it is important that now is the early time when we will get two types of trophoblast. The cytotrophoblast, which are the inner layer of mononucleated cells, and outer multinucleated zone forms the syncytial trophoblast. Now this inner cell mass is the embryoblast, which will differentiate into hypoblast and epiblast. So which is the stage we have entered now? It's the bilaminar germ disc. So there are two layers, hypoblast, epiblast. Now, epiblast cells adjacent to cytotrophoblast is going to form the amnioblasts, which will line the amniotic cavity. And the syncytial trophoblast shows a large number of lacuna. The book which we refer is Langmann, you all know. Now, when you open Langmann, you will find beautiful diagrams of the lacuna and the syncytial and the cytotrophoblast. Remember, for your purpose, syncytial trophoblast is actually peripheral and cytotrophoblast is inside along the inner cell mass. So now we have got the bilaminar germ disc, which consists of epiplast cells, which is columnar, and hypoplast cells, which is cuboidal. On the day 9, when it is embedded in the endometrium, when it gets embedded, the area, or after it gets embedded, there will be an area which will be empty. And this is covered by the fibrin coagulum. Now, in the layer of the syncytium, along the syncytial trophoblast, there will be lacuna appearing. What a lacuna? In between the cells, gaps will be created. Initially, this lacuna will be empty. Now, this what is Heuser's membrane? It is the inner surface of the cytotrophoblast together with the hypoblast, which forms the primitive yolk sac. Please remember it, because this is important. In the days 11 and 12, it is seen that in the area of the syncytial trophoblast, the whole thing gets filled with maternal capillaries and blood. So blood from the maternal side. Therefore, if I ask you, where is syncytial trophoblast? Towards the maternal side. Where is cytotrophoblast? Towards the fetal side. Therefore, in the syncytial trophoblast, all the sinusoids are filled with maternal blood, gets dilated and congested, which we call sinusoids. Now, these are the syncytial lacunae, which are filled with blood, and this is the initiation of the uteroplacental circulation. Similarly, in the days 11 and 12, again, the extra embryonic mesoderm, I'm sure you are aware of these terms, because this is a crash course where I'm just picking up what is most important for you to remember. So there will be two types, somatopleuric mesoderm and splanchnopleuric mesoderm. And when this mesoderm is coming into picture, it is in the implantation site. These are the decidual reactionary changes. On the day 13, another structure comes. It's the villi. Initially, if you see Landmann, it gives a beautiful diagram. Very crisp, short, small diagram. 3. Primary villus, secondary villus, tertiary villus. So please practice the villi as a short note and practice these 3 diagrams, because the cells of cytotrophoblast proliferate and penetrate into syncytial trophoblast to form primary villus. Now, this primary villus, basically, we will see how it changes to when it gets a mesodermal core, it becomes a secondary villus. When it gets the blood vessels, the maternal capillaries in it, it becomes a tertiary villus. Now, hypoblast, it produces additional cells. Now, when you are drawing, please color epiblast and hypoblast as two separate colors. You will see Langmann has given yellow and blue color. It forms a new cavity within the exocoelomic cavity, which is called the secondary yolk sac or the definitive yolk sac. Now, in this process of formation, what happens is exocoelomic cavity, large portions get detached and they form the cysts, and it becomes like a chorionic cavity. Now, when you open up the diagram on the Langmann, you will find exocoelomic cysts in 1 or 2 illustrations. And this extraembryonic mesoderm traverses the chorionic cavity in connecting stalk. And when there are blood vessels which are developing, it becomes the umbilical cord. So you have to know the development, because it's coming from the connecting stalk with the extraembryonic mesoderm. When it gets channelized with blood vessels, becomes the umbilical cord. Now, Another important thing is, it is the human chorionic gonadotropin, which by end of second week sufficient to be detected for pregnancy testing. So when we sent for pregnancy testing, it is actually we want to identify and isolate whether HCG is present or not. There are certain conditions where, say, systemic lupus erythematosus, these are autoimmune diseases, SLE. The antibodies are generated which are detrimental for the conceptors and it leads to spontaneous abortion. Therefore, I have already written, please read the implantation sites and practice the diagrams, short note, MCQ, Viva, and OSCE. Now, another, when we are blastocyst is getting implanted, if it gets implanted near the internal opening of the os of cervix, it reaches the left. It covers either completely or partially. We call that condition placenta previa. If it is severe, it leads to serious bleeding and sometimes abortion. Others is ectopic pregnancy. I will not go into much details of it. I want you to practice with a labeled diagram. What are the probable sites? Abdominal cavity, ovary, uterine tube, 95% occur in uterine tube ampulla. So where fertilization takes place, there only implantation takes place. So it doesn't actually move towards the posterior wall of the uterus. And this is a common clinical condition which you will get in your lifetime. Now, there is another very interesting condition known as hydatidiform mole, where trophoblast forms the placental membranes and there is no embryonic tissue, but there is secretion of HCG, which can be benign or malignant. And if it is malignant, it can lead to choriocarcinoma. So we call it H-mole. Now, why this is very important, as I said, because of the abortions, because of the ectopic pregnancy and infertility. So we finished the second week. So what did we see in the second week is basically the syncytial trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, lacuna, initiation of uteroplacental circulation, getting the blood vessels from the maternal site. Then there can be extraembryonic coelom and the cysts which can be there, epiblast and hypoblast, implantation and placenta previa as a clinical condition, ectopic pregnancy as another clinical condition. This embryo goes to the third week. So we have already seen this. Blastocyst has got embedded and maternal blood has entered the lacuna network. Then this is end of second week. So the uteroplacental circulation has started and you have already seen the primary villus. And when the blastocyst has got embedded, there is an opening which is covered by the fibrin coagulum. Now, you have seen also the epiblast and the hypoblast and the extraembryonic mesoderm. Next is, I have already done this. So there is one term which is known as gastrulation. Gastrulation is nothing but it is basically bilaminar to trilaminar germ disc. And here you can see the primitive streak and it ends in a primitive pit and the primitive node, which is cephalic, cranial. So this is the cephalic end of the streak and cells of the epiblast migrate towards this. It invaginates, displays some hypoblast cells and it creates the endoderm. So from where is endoderm coming? Endoderm is coming from the epiblast cells migrating towards the primitive node, replacing the hypoblast cells, forming the innermost layer, which is endoderm. Then we get the, between the epiblast and the endoderm, we get mesoderm. Will you please mute yourself? And cells in epiblast form the ectoderm. So epiblast through gastrulation is the source of all germ layers. Remember this, because cells of epiblast is migrating, replacing the hypoblast. So gastrulation is a potential shortcut. So this is how the migration takes place in the cephalic direction. Then it also sidewise also there is migration, and there is the formation of the buccopharyngeal membrane cranially. This is basically the future opening of the oral cavity. And precordal plate, it some first migrating cephalic cells, it's important for the formation of the forebrain, which we will see in our next class. So this is just a horizontal or a transverse section. Now you can see the pre-notochordal cells invaginating in the primitive peat and forming this black notochordal plate here, and it forms the definitive notochord. And just behind it, you get the neuroenteric canal, which connects the amniotic and the yolk sac. So amniotic sac, yolk sac connected by neuroenteric canal. And what is there? This yellow tail-like thing posteriorly is the cloacal membrane. So it is at the caudal end of the embryonic disc. It consists of the ectoderm and endoderm cells. So this is a same diagram, which is little elaborate. And you get the ectoderm here, the blue structure. The red one is the mesoderm, which is invaginating between the ecto, and the yellow structure is the endoderm. So what happens is the cloacal membrane, which is on the posterior wall of the yolk sac, it forms a small diverticulum. You can see the tail-shaped diverticulum. This is known as the allantoenteric diverticulum or the allantois. Simultaneously, the body axes are also formed, anteroposteriorly, dorsoventrally, transversely, left to right. So this is also a part of the gastrulation. So what is actually gastrulation is nothing but the initial beginning of the ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderm. How is it initiated? Cells of epiblast, which move cranially, replaces hypoblast, first forms the endoderm. Lateral cells, they migrate inside to form the mesoderm, and the on top we get the ectoderm. So this is the fate map we can see. Now what is most, so some cells increase to cranial region of node, becomes notochord. What is most important is the black one is the notochord. Let us look at the red structure. On either side of the laterally, this is called paraxial mesoderm. And then in the middle region is the intermediate region, mesoderm. So intermediate mesoderm. And the most laterally, alongside the cloacal membrane, we get the lateral plate mesoderm. So the mesoderm, this diagram is important. Notochord, paraxial mesoderm, intermediate mesoderm, and lateral plate mesoderm. Now, the next point is, you have already seen the primitive streak. The premenstrual streak now shows regressive changes. It shrinks and soon disappears. Now what happens is, so you have initiated. Now when we do embryology, we don't do it as one system, one system, one system. We do it holistically. The human being or the embryo is developing. So gastrulation is nothing but formation of germless, continuous cranial and caudal, and cranial structures are differentiating, causing embryo develop cephalocaudally. What do you mean by the word cephalocaudally? Means both cranially and caudally. Now, what are the clinical correlates here? That is, when we see the beginning of third week, when the gastrulation is initiated, we will see that the face is formed with eyes and everything. The brain is also developing. Suppose there is high dose of alcohol as a teratogen, where we can get hollow prosencephaly. Prosencephalon gives rise to forebrain. So there is a defect in the development where teratogenic input is coming from the high doses of regular intake of alcohol by the mother. Now, forebrain can become small also, with everything small, all ventricles small, minimized, eyes small and close together, face small. This is called hypotelorism. Next is, there are other genetic abnormalities and toxic insults where caudal dysgenesis occurs, insufficient mesoderm is formed. We call it sirenomalia. So what will happen here? There will be difficulty in the lower limb, urogenital system, lumbosacral vertebrae, whatever is developing from the mesoderm, particularly the intermediate mesoderm, will be in trouble. Situs inversus is another clinical condition. What does the word itself mean? Means that the transposition of the viscera in the thorax and abdomen, which is happening about in 20% patients, and when there is additional bronchiectasis and sinusitis, we call it cartilaginous syndrome or abnormal cilia. There can be laterally sequenced with heart defects. Only the heart is not in the normal position. Abnormal side. So left side to right side. Patients with these conditions do not have complete situs inversus. So situs inversus is an important shortcut. But you may also be asked in orals about hypotelorism or hollow prosencephaly, or you can be given an MCQ on this. So tumors with gastrulation are basically arising from the primitive streak because the cells, the epiplasts were going towards it and was replacing the hypoplast to form the endoderm, then intervention intermediate mesoderm, then it comes the ectoderm. So the tumors can be sacrococcygeal teratomas. So it is a tumor which is found in newborns, 1 in 37,000. But it may contain tissues which are derived from all three germ layers. Now, when we go into a little detail, as I say, you practice this diagram of primary, secondary, and tertiary villus. I have already told you, primary villus is cytotrophoblast covered by syncytial trophoblast. Secondary villus, you get the core of syncytium mesodermal, and this is the mesoderm of the villus, and when it has the blood vessels, which is called tertiary villus or the definitive placental villus. So if you remember even this much along with the diagram, just put a little blood vessel in the tertiary villus, a mesodermal core in the secondary villus, and primary villus is just syncytio outside, inside is cytotrophin. You get almost full marks. Therefore, you can see that we straight go here that the villi that extend from the chorionic plate to decidua basalis, that is the decidual plate, which is the part of endometrium where placenta is forming. Now, this is known as anchoring villi. Now, we have to see these villi initially are finger-like projections. Later on, what happens is it becomes there is a tree-like with branches. So, this is the anchoring and stem villus, and you know how the umbilical cord is formed. Now, embryonic period is nothing but it's the period of organogenesis from 3rd to 8th week of development. What is neurulation then? The neural plate, the neuroectoderm, what we saw, the primitive node, the notochord, that is neurulation. This is, I want you to remember thoroughly, the neural crest derivatives, comes short code, oral, everything. It's very important. So what are the derivatives of trilaminar germ disc? Ectodermal germ, because you are usually asked in Viva, tell two derivatives of ectodermal germ layer. CNS, peripheral nervous system, eye, skin, hair, nail, pituitary, everything. Mesodermal are the paraxial mesoderm, gives the somites, the myotomes, dermatomes, the sclerotomes, and the endodermal layer is the all these tracts, GI tract, respiratory tract, urinary bladder, all these. So remember, my dear students, for each, at least remember three examples. That will be enough. Coming to placenta, a very quick recapitulation. Most important salient points. Now, what is the fetal period? So two definitions is a must. Period of organogenesis is the embryonic period, and fetal period is till the 9th week, from the 9th week to birth. So here you see the crown rump length, the crown hill length, what is seen in the ultrasound. And the growth in length and the weight can be identified. Length of pregnancy, you all know, 280 days. From the last normal menstrual period. Either it can be, the fetus can be premature or postmature. Ultrasound accurate can be done, measurement of CRL, that is crown rump length, during 7 to 14 weeks. Or you can also see the biparietal diameter. In the 3rd month, as I have said, the face becomes more human looking. And the sex of the fetus can be identified. Now, this is very important. What is the most important of 6th week is the intestinal loops, they come out. Then by 12th week, it goes back. What is the condition known as the physiological herniation? This is a very important short note. Physiological hernia, what we do in the GIT. So end of 3rd month is the muscular cavity. Initiation of the muscular activity, so the mother can now start feeling the movements and other activities. The 4th and 5th month, fetus is lengthening and weight is very, it increases very less, it lengthens more, and by end of 5th month, it is still less than 500 grams, but fetal movements are conspicuously felt by the mother in the 5th month onwards. 2nd half of intrauterine life, 6th month is the wrinkled appearance. Because why I am telling is because you will in your exams as well as in your later on postings, you will see these fetuses and these aborted fetuses. And fetus born early in 6th month, difficulty in surviving because of the respiratory system, you know, the surfactant. So it is not fully secreted and CNS is not differentiated. Now, last 2 months is basically there is vernix caseosa. What is it? You can be asked in orals. If you are given a placenta, if you are given a fetus, or you can be given a model or a chart and can be asked. Now, end of ninth month, skull has the largest circumference of all parts of the body. And fetal weight is normally 3,000 to 3,400. If it is less, it is called intrauterine growth retardation, IUGR. And sexual characteristics are seen. Now, placenta is basically as the fetus grows, there are major changes in the placenta. There is increased surface area. And what is decidua? The uterine endometrium, what is changing is the decidua. So endometrium becomes secretory, and after implantation, there is vacuolation, so which is called decidual reaction. Please do what is decidual reaction as shown. So there are changes in trophoblast in the villi, which I have already said. Now there is chorionic, frondosum, and decidual basalis. I have talked about the villi. I'm not doing it anymore. Now decidua over the chorion, frondosum, decidua basalis, it is composed of a compact layer of large cells. Please see what is chorionic frondosum in the Langmann. I teach from Langmann. My acknowledgement goes there. Now, structure of a full-term placenta, this is important. It is basically, this is very important. This comes as short note n number of times. It has two components, a fetal portion, that is the chorionic frondosum, and maternal portion, which is decidua basalis. Fetal portion, that is chorionic frondosum, develops from chorionic plate. And it is discoid in nature, about 500 to 600 grams weight. And it is expelled after about 30 minutes, within 30 minutes of the birth of the fetus. In the maternal side, there are bulgings or cotyledons. And these grooves between cotyledons are formed by the decidual septa. Chorion is covered by amnion. You will have to read about what is umbilical cord. Now, circulation, I will just do this. This is a very important short note, placental barrier, because there was question whether corona crosses the placental barrier, whether HIV crosses, whether hepatitis C virus crosses. There are n number of virus and n number of medicines. So placental barrier is basically chronologically endothelial lining of fetal blood vessels, connective tissue in villus core, cytotrophoblastic layer, and syncytia. It is hemochorial type. I will not go into the details of functions of placenta, which I presume you know. There is exchange of nutrients, maternal antibodies. Remember about the IgGs. It's very important. Hormone production. Please do the functions of placenta. It is very, very important. What are the placental changes at the end of pregnancy? There is increase in fibrous tissue in the core of villus. So no more uteroplacental circulation is needed. Basement membrane is thickened. Capillaries are obliterated. So it gives a whitish appearance. Now coming to the amnion, I just have about two or three slides more. Amnion and umbilical cord. Please read about the amnion, because there are two, three things for the amniotic fluid which I want you to remember. One is, it is about a liter at term, 1500 ml or more is hydramnios, too little is oligohydramnios. It starts with about 30 ml and goes to about 1000 ml. Now, it absorbs, prevents adherence of embryo to amnion, and allows fetal movements. It is replaced every 3 hours. And fetus swallows the amniotic fluid. It drinks about 400 ml a day. And fetal urine gets added to it. When we see the twinnings, dizygotic and monozygotic, it's a topic which you find both in genetics as well as embryology. You know, in the dizygotic, it has totally different two different genetic constitutions. So its implantations are individual, with individual placenta, amnion, and chorionic sac. Sometimes two placentas are so close that they fuse. Whereas in monozygotic, it is with the one, and it is basically, though the implantation is separate, each embryo with its own placenta and chorionic sac, but two embryos later on have a common placenta and a common chorionic cavity, but separate amniotic cavities. So dizygotic, these are the two fundamental differences. You can work on it more in the genetics point of view. The placental anomalies are, it is normally disc-shaped, discoid, but if it is bidiscoidal, 2 disc, lobe, diffuse. Practice this with a label with the diagrams, because placenta succinturiata means a part is separated, fenestrated means there is a hole in it, circumvallate means peripherally there is a fold. Similarly, for the umbilical cord, it should be near the center. But if it is peripheral, marginal, it is called battledore placenta. If the blood vessels of the umbilical cord divide before reaching, it is called farcate. And if it ramifies, it's velamentous. So the short notes which I want you to practice are villi, zona pellucida, implantation, fertilization, ectopic pregnancy, cleavage, morula, embryonic and fetal periods, corpus luteum, placenta, bilaminar, trilaminar, germ disc and derivatives, umbilical cord anomalies, trophoblast, uteroplacental circulation, twinnings, maturation of oocytes, spermatogenesis, spermiogenesis, how does a matured sperm look like, polar bodies, gametogenesis, teratoma, gastrulation and neurulation. This is more than enough when you do the general embryology. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. Dear viewers, if you have any doubts, you can raise your hands in this Zoom meeting. It will be answered shortly. Dear viewers, if you have any queries, please raise your hand in Zoom meeting.
Otherwise, I would request you, I would ask you, my students, to refer to Langman. That's the best book. It has plenty of diagrams. It's very clear. Even if you read only the diagrams, it will be enough for you to do well in anatomy. But embryology in anatomy, embryology and osteology in anatomy makes you pass or fail.
Ma'am, please hold on a bit. Dear viewers, yes. You are having still interesting sessions upcoming next to this. In the second session scheduled today between 6:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m., Dr. R. Selvakumar handling a session on mechanical injuries from forensic medicine. We still have some interesting sessions scheduled tomorrow. In session one, between 5 p.m. to 6 p.m., Dr. Meenakshi handling a topic, portal hypertension from medicine. And in the session two, between 6:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m., Dr. Sangeeta Patel handling a topic, CNS, synapse examination division from physiology. Dear viewers, if you have any queries, you can raise your hands now and get it clarified. Ma'am, I think there are no queries from the participants.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye.